بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Most Merciful.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين. نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We always praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. May Allah bless them all and may he bless every single one of us. Ameen. My beloved brothers and sisters, on the globe several incidents have occurred that make it necessary for us to speak about them and to guide the Muslims in their regard. One of these was the siege that happened in Sydney, Australia, and the other was the massacre of school children in Peshawar, Pakistan. And it's important for us to know that as Muslims, we don't understand what part of Islam these people are following. In fact, we don't even understand what Islam they are following, because Islam is a totally different religion from what these people are practicing. Islam does not teach the killing of innocent people. It does not teach the killing of children and women. And in fact, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was entering Makkatul Mukarramah in the year known as Amul Fath, at the victory of Mecca, he made it quite clear that those who put their weapon down as well shall not be touched and harmed. These are innocent people. Also, he makes clear mention of not only the prohibition of hurting or harming women, children, the elderly, those who are in their homes, those who are in the churches, but he even speaks about the destruction of trees and infrastructure. So those who destroy infrastructure are not following Islam. Those who want to destroy the ecosystem are not following Islam. Those who want to harm women, children, the elderly, and those who are in the masajid, and those who are not at war with them, innocent people, they are not following Islam. And this is why it's important for us to speak about this, because as frustrated as we might be because of what might be happening on Muslim lands, it does not give us the right to go out and hurt people who are not at all involved. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and may He protect us. The first issue I want to address is the issue of hostage taking in Islam. What has happened and what is happening? If you take a careful look, someone has a problem with a certain nationality and they decide to pick up anyone of the same nationality and kill him off or use him as a hostage. Which part of Islam teaches that? Which hadith or which Quranic verse teaches that? When a person is innocent, not at all involved, there are people, whether they are in Iraq, whether they are in Syria, whether they are in other places, some of them have gone forth in order to assist humanitarian crisis we all know about. There are people who have gone to help and they have gone under the flag of well-known Islamic organizations as well. And after a while, the man is taken, and after a while, just because of his nationality, he is then made a big issue of, and an issue of hostage and so on, and after a while, he is executed in the name of Islam. You and I are not involved. You and I condemn that, and we do not condone it at all. So this barbaric system is definitely un-Islamic. If you take a look at the Islam we have been following since we were born, we have known of a peaceful Islam. We live with the Muslims, with the non-Muslims, the people of the book, the Jews and the Christians and the others, the Hindus, people who don't even have a faith. Where have we ever had dispute with them in terms of living and life and their freedom? The reality is, as Muslimin, no, we don't. If you have a problem with someone, you may report them to the authorities and then it will be handled by the courts. You will either get justice at the courts, or sometimes maybe the courts may find someone that you believe is guilty, innocent. In that case, you leave it for the day of judgment when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be the judge. But you do not take it into your own hands to say, now because the court has found this person innocent, and according to me the person is guilty, let me harm them, let me kill them, let me hurt them, let me rob from them. That is absolutely incorrect and it is un-Islamic. Because what we do know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about himself judging between two people. He says, I am definitely a human being just like you. Ala innama ana basharun mithlukum wa innama ya'tini al-khasm fala'alla ba'dhukum an yakuna ablagha bi hujjatihi min ba'd. The Prophet ﷺ says, when there is a dispute between us, then, or when there is a dispute between two people who come to me, I will listen to the evidence. Maybe one person can speak better than the other. Maybe one person has a little advantage over the other. And I will give a ruling based on the evidence, based on what is being said and based on what the evidence is and the witness and so on. If something happens to be false and I happen to issue a ruling based on what was wrong, then the person should know, فَإِنَّمَا هِيَ قِطْعَةٌ مِّنَ النَّارِ فَلْيَأْخُذْهَا أَوْ لِيَذَرْهَا. The Prophet ﷺ says, what I have given them wrongfully is actually a piece of the fire. If they want, they can take it, and if they want, they can leave it. So if they've taken it, they will have to pay on the day of judgment, and perhaps they will lose their Jannah. And if they have left it, then inshallah, they will be able to earn justice at least on the day of judgment, because they were bothered about justice here. If you take a careful look at Pakistan, and what happened in Pakistan just 2 days ago, where more than 100 little children were killed. For what? What was the purpose? Why? So someone might argue that, oh, these were the children of military men. That is no justification whatsoever. Look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam when he went to Taif. Look at his example. They beat him up personally, physically. He was bleeding, and the angels came to him to say, if you want, we can crush these people between the mountains. What did he say? He said, I am sent as a mercy. We don't want that to happen. If they don't accept, perhaps their children will accept. Patience, sabr. You want people to come to Islam. To me, every non-Muslim is a potential Muslim, which means he can be a Muslim. So it's up to me, my character, my conduct, the way I deal with him, the way I talk to him or her, and the way I interact. They should be attracted to Islam. But if I am taught to kill off all non-Muslims, who is going to accept Islam? What about my forefathers, some generations back, maybe 500 years, 1,000 years, whenever it was, they were not Muslim. So if the teaching was that you need to kill off the non-Muslim, I would not be standing here, nor would you. Because at some stage far back, they were not Muslim. So it's important for us to know this. In Taif, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was patient. He made a dua for them, a beautiful dua. He took the knock, meaning he did not make a bad dua against them. And at the same time, he made a good dua. Oh Allah, if these people are not accepting, at least from their progeny, from their offspring, from their children, let people accept the deen. In a few years' time, there was a victory in that region. Today, take a look at Taif and tell me how many non-Muslims there are there. Why? There was patience. There was a lot of forbearance. There was a system of da'wah. People have lost the plot, and we think that the non-Muslims are our enemies. The minute we think that, automatically we will not be able to call them towards Islam, and they will get the wrong image of Islam. Because if we look at, from amongst us seated here, there are so many who were non-Muslim before, or their fathers or forefathers were non-Muslim. And not very long time ago, recently, but what happened? Someone somehow came and did good business with them. A good business deal. So many people accepted Islam because they saw upright people. Also, what has happened is sometimes people have worked at someone's business or at someone's home. They have seen upright character. This person is straight. They pay me on time. They don't swear. They speak proper good words. They are honest. They are polite. They treat me like a human being. And they feel in their heart, let me accept Islam. What is this? It is definitely the faith. We don't drink. We don't commit adultery. We don't go into the clubs. And the issues and problems that are being faced by the majority of the globe, a true Muslim will not face those issues because you don't have those problems. So this is why, let's be careful. Let us understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed a duty on our shoulders to sort problems out, not to create problems. We should never ever create a problem. You and I have sent our children to school. And subhanAllah, these school children are growing up. They are innocent. Perhaps if we are making a mistake, tomorrow they will correct us. Look at Ibrahim alayhi salam. He was the son of a bad man. You know this? Azar was a bad man. He used to worship idols. He used to do so much of evil. What happened? Ibrahim alayhi salam, Allah decided to guide him. That alone proves that no matter how bad your father is, it does not make the children that bad. The children are innocent. These are innocent children. The whole globe acknowledges they are innocent. Yes, they are. There are others who have pillaged and slaughtered our own children. We know, but two wrongs do not make a right. Remember this. Someone sometimes might want to think and try and justify to say, you know, they are bombing us every day. They are killing our children every day. They are doing this on a daily basis with unmanned aircraft and various other things. My brother, my sister, we understand we are paining, we are hurting, we are bleeding. We want to solve the problem. We are trying to sort things out. But at the same time, it does not give us the right. And it does not justify the killing of innocent children. If someone has murdered someone else, subhanAllah, it does not give us the right to murder a third party altogether. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And may Allah grant us guidance and ease. It's important we understand this. The world is bleeding today and people are blaming the Muslims. Because from amongst us, some are being brainwashed. Brainwashed by what? They do not understand verses of the Quran. They don't understand the asbabun nuzul or the reasons of revelation of the verses of the Quran. They don't understand how to extract rules and regulations from verses of the Quran. They read something, someone shows them something, and next thing they are prepared to give up their lives. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. We should be giving up our lives, striving to earn the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through obedience, through salah. What is ironic is a person who cannot get up for Salatul Fajr and a person who is delayed for the other salawat, a person who perhaps has not even fulfilled the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his or her life, suddenly lines up as a suicide bomber. A'udhu billah. Where is this from? My brother, start with your salah and understand that if you do it properly, you'll never get to the end that you are going towards. Why? Because you would have proper knowledge. You would understand that this is not it. Islam prohibits suicide. If a person kills himself, what will happen? That person, the hadith already says, in fact, the Quran speaks of it. وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا. Do not kill yourself. Do not harm yourself. For indeed, Allah is very merciful upon you. Similarly, Allah says, وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ وَأَحْسِنُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Do not use your own hands to harm yourselves. Be good, be kind, for Allah loves those who are good and kind. Imagine, kindness on top of that, goodness on top of that. Do you know that even if there is an animal, we are not allowed to just take the life of an animal aimlessly. Those who go out fishing and you know, as a sport, and they catch the fish and let it be, you know, harmed, and after a little while they throw it back in, and every time you catch this big fish, you find that, you know, part of its mouth is injured because of others who have caught the fish and they've taken it out and put it back. That, according to us, is not allowed, because you are harming and a creature of Allah, and you will taste the wrath of it somewhere down your life. The same applies if we were to do something just as a sport. You know, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ says, never use a living animal as a target. So people look at targets, they look at an animal, okay guys, you want to shoot, let's go and shoot these animals. And you shoot the animal and you leave it. What was it for? Just to know how to aim? Why couldn't you have used a brick? Why couldn't you have used a little dart board or something else? Why do you have to use a living animal or a living creature? The hadith says it is haram. Haram meaning it's not allowed. That is a creature of Allah. Why are you taking the life away of a creature of Allah? Imagine if it's a human being, subhanAllah. Imagine if it's a human being. And on top of that, imagine if it is someone who's saying the shahada. The little children that went off in Pakistan, may Allah grant them Jannah, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it a means of their parents' forgiveness and entry into Jannah as well. No justification whatsoever. Imagine, they were reciting the shahada. They were at a school where the Quran was being taught. And here you have people in the name of the same Quran, and they are going through, nay, they did not do that in my name and in yours. Not at all. We disagree, and we very strongly disagree. So this is why it's important for us to make mention of this in order to educate the Muslim masses. Do not be from amongst those who loses the plot or who becomes so upset that what you start doing is wrong. You know, sometimes, yes, and I'm repeating this, we become upset, we become hurt because we see what's happening to our brothers, our sisters. But the solution is not to do something that is worse or equal. No, the solution is to solve the matter in a different way. Today, let's face it, in our own societies and communities, we are split into 20, 30 groups. One brother doesn't want to see the other brother because he says Ameen aloud and this one says it softly. And one, when he's sitting in tashahud, he'll put his finger up and down and the other one just leaves it up and one doesn't do it. So we are fighting, we are not talking. This one is a kafir, this one is a non-Muslim, this one is a, you know, this one. There will always be difference of opinion in the ummah. You will not be able to banish difference. There was difference of opinion even in the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. But unity is how to deal with difference of opinion. That is unity. That will make you be united or disunited. So if you know how to deal with difference, brother, I love the color blue. You love the color green. Alhamdulillah, you are my brother. I will greet you. You can carry on enjoying your green. I will enjoy my blue and so on. But I don't agree with you and your color choice. But I love you because we share the shahada. The same applies. I might be a Maliki. You might be a Shafi'i. The other one might be a Hanafi or the other one might be a Salafi. Whatever it is, these people say the shahada. They say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. Hisabuhum ala Allah. After that, their account is with Allah. If you want to discuss something, no problem. But to start labeling and harming and wanting to hurt and going around backbiting and spreading mischief and tale and creating stories and disuniting the ummah, the day a disaster has to strike, we will only be killing one another. We will only be killing one another. Why? We have more differences amongst us than we do with the Jewish neighbor and with the Christian neighbor. Subhanallah. And this is why we say, as Muslims, there is a uniform rule. No matter who it is, to start with, it's a human being, number one. Thereafter, they have rights. Let me give you one simple example. There is the explanation of the neighbor and the rights of a neighbor in Islam. And it is quite clear that if he is a neighbor who is a non-Muslim, he has one right over you. He's a neighbor. If he's a neighbor who is a Muslim, he has two rights over you because he's a neighbor and he's a Muslim. If he's a neighbor and a Muslim and a relative, he has three rights over you because of all three things. And so on. And if he's a neighbor and he's a relative and he's a Muslim and he's sick and ill, then he has another right known as the rights of those who are sick and ill, and you are the neighbor. If there is a funeral at that house, you also have another right to fulfill. This is Islam. This is what we know about. We have been living with people who are non-Muslim for decades on end. In our own lives, I'm talking about, we've never had a problem. We have a live and let live policy. They would come to us. I have had in my own home Jehovah's Witnesses who have come and they have wanted to discuss religion and we've discussed it. So they came in and they've discussed whatever they wanted. They were satisfied and they left. I did not spit on them. I did not treat them in an evil way because they were coming to fulfill what they felt is a duty. And I have been to several people's homes in order to talk about Islam. And I was welcome. And subhanallah, sometimes not only homes, but I've even been to schools and various other places where they've invited me to say, come and talk about Islam. Let's hear what it's all about. And they, we've answered questions and they were very respectful. This is the way things should be done, very respectfully. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in alayka illa al-balagh. In another place, ma ala al-rasooli illa al-balagh. Wallahu ya'lamu ma tubduna wa the duty of the messenger is to deliver the message. Once you've delivered the message, the hisab is on Allah. I cannot force hidayah down your throat. Look at Abu Talib. He was the uncle of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was not a Muslim. He was not a Christian. He was not a Jew. He was an idol worshipper. Those are worse than the Jews and the Christians. But he supported Islam. He supported Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He actually went out in defense of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to say that if anyone touches this nephew of mine, they have touched me. I will fight them. This was Abu Talib. The day he passed away, that year was known as Amul Huzn, the year of sadness, because the Prophet ﷺ was sad, but this was a non-Muslim who died. And on his deathbed, something interesting happened. The Prophet ﷺ says, Ya Am, qul kalimatan uhajju laka biha yawm al-qiyamah. Oh my uncle, say one statement. Say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Say it. Just utter it. I will fight your case on the day of Qiyamah. And what happened? Subhanallah. He didn't want to utter it because of the others who were around. There were some of the cronies of the mushrikeen who were nearby. And so he looked at them and he didn't want to utter it. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sad. When he was sad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded him to say, you know what? Hidayah and guidance is not in your hands. You only have the hidayah known as ad-dalala wal-irshad. You can only guide them by showing them the path and telling them this is the right thing. But whether or not they accept it, at-tawfiq, whether they are going to get that acceptance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to follow the path is in the hands of Allah. So Allah says,
إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِالْمُهْتَدِينَ.
You, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do not guide whomsoever you wish. It is Allah who guides whomsoever He wishes, and He is all-knowing of who is rightly guided. Sometimes a person might come to you pretending to be a Muslim and they are not. And sometimes a person might come to you, oh, only Allah knows what is in their heart. A person wants to accept Islam, something is delaying them. Sometimes a person, from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a person who does bad, evil deeds for 70 years, right near the end of his life, he turned, he made tawbah, he asked Allah's forgiveness, he read the shahada, whatever he did in terms of tawbah, and Allah says he got Jannah, he got paradise. But his whole life he led in a bad way. That is Allah. Allah loved him for some reason. And sometimes there is a person who does good deeds. He might read salah in the first saf. He might give a lot of charity. He might do so much of good. But right at the end, something bad happens and he goes to Jahannam. So it is up to Allah to guide. This is why there is also another narration called Hadith al-Muflis. The person who is bankrupt is the one who has a lot of salah, he has a lot of zakah, a lot of good deeds, but his heart was dirty. The heart. How was it dirty? He had cheated this one, he had enmity against this one, he was backbiting this one, he usurped the wealth of that one. So on the day of judgment, all his good deeds are given away. This one takes this, that one takes that, that one takes that, this one takes the other thing. And what happens? Every deed of his is finished, but there are still people whom he owes things to. So some of their bad deeds will come onto him. May Allah not do that to us. May He forgive us. My brothers and sisters, Islam, it means peace. It stands for peace. It promotes peace. It teaches peace. And everything that you will achieve is peace. In this world, peace. In the next, peace. In your grave, peace. With your children, peace. In your environment, peace. That is Islam. Anything that destroys that in any way is not Islam. Remember this. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us. Sometimes we become impatient. And I will end with this piece of advice. We have problems because Allah put us in the world to test us. Allah did not put us in this world to enjoy. Nobody is enjoying. Nobody. Even the wealthiest person cannot sleep sometimes. He has other problems which you don't have and I don't have. Even a person who doesn't have anything, maybe he's got good health. You know, I normally tell people, those who are very rich, they can afford expensive food. Expensive food comes with sickness. You must remember this. The cheap food doesn't come with sickness. You know, from amongst us, those who eat sadza and mriwo, how many of you have a huge cholesterol problem? Nil, zero. The doctors say it's only when you start eating pizza and you start eating expensive food and you want to have burgers and coke, you have a big problem. But so Allah's blessed some with different types of issues. You don't understand. It's a fact of life. And this is why we say, take a look at Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his life. You will learn a lot. Allah did not make him a rich man. Allah kept him standard. Standard. There were days when they didn't have anything to eat. Aisha radiallahu anha says, in kunna ala Muhammadin, even though we were the family of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we had 1 month, we saw the moon, another month, we saw the moon, another month, we saw the moon, and we didn't light a stove in our house. Subhanallah. Anyone is as poor as that? Put up your hand. 3 months, no food. Have you had that? No one. That is the best of creation. Afdhalul khalq wa akramur rusul. And look at what he went through. This is a test of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have much more. We are sometimes ungrateful. But the point I was raising is, Allah will create difficulty in our lives in order to test us, because we were brought into this world for a test. So you have a health problem, you have either major or minor, a financial problem, major or minor, social problem, major or minor. It has to come. Nobody can avoid this. It has to come. That is your test from Allah. That's why He created you. So what should you do? Be steadfast. Ask Allah's goodness and be steadfast. Continue making dua and don't lose hope. That's the beauty. So some people say, how can I keep on making dua my whole life? That's what is called kufr.
That is disbelief. You are turning away from Allah. You are becoming impatient with Allah. Make dua. Look at Ayyub alayhi salam. He made a dua for how many years on end? He carried on making. One narration says his wife was asking him that, you know, now, in fact, at one stage he didn't even want to make the dua because he said, Allah's given me ni'mah for so long and I still haven't suffered for that long. Subhanallah. And his wife is busy telling him, why don't you ask Allah? But look at us. We ask Allah today, we ask Allah tomorrow. By Sunday, if nothing comes, we are upset, we are angry. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. You ask for 1 year, 2 years, 20 years, 40 years. Maybe in your life you won't see it, but in the next life your children will see it. How do you know? Don't lose patience. Or ask Allah. And also what is important is al-akhdhu bil asbab. That means when you are asking Allah, if Allah has given you the capacity to do something, then you should fulfill it. Like I'm asking Allah, oh Allah, help me with wealth, help me with sustenance. But I am able, I'm capable, I don't want to work, I don't want to go and look for a job. If that is the case, you are playing the fool with Allah. This is why the hadith says, you want your camel to be protected. First you tie it, and then you say, oh Allah, look after my camel, and then you go away. Because Allah gave you the capacity. My brothers and sisters, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. I chose to speak about this because it's bubbling in our hearts. We are hurting, we are bleeding for so many things that are happening on the globe. But it should never be that we are to blame. We are clear cut, we are following the Islam, the mainstream Islam, that which is understood by the bulk of the globe. These few exceptions that we do have, they do not represent Islam. We are peaceful and we preach peace. And this is why we say, if anyone comes to any one of us here, and if anyone tries to instigate violence, please do yourself and the rest of the ummah a favor by reporting them to the police, no matter what. Because the day there is a disaster, we don't want ourselves to be blamed. And we don't even want that disaster to come. So our teachings are quite clear and open. If there is someone instigating violence, please don't think you can handle it on your own. Go and report him. As a Muslim, it is your duty. You owe it to the rest of the Muslims. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala correct us, rectify us, grant us guidance. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabina Muhammad.